Council meeting at ministerial level of the European Space Agency. We are together with two co-chairs this time around, and I'd like to introduce you to François Bielkin, who is the Minister of Higher Education and Research from Luxembourg. Then we have our Director General, Jean-Jacques Dordain, Director General of the European Space Agency. Sitting next to him is the second co-chair for the events, and it's Minister Mauro Dell'Ambrogio, State Secretary for Education and Research for Switzerland. And then we have, sitting next to him, Minister Francesco Profumo, who's the Minister of Education, Universities and Research, and he is the outgoing chair, and Italy has been the host country, so we invited him to sit with us. I leave the floor in the order to François Bielkin, to Mauro Dell'Ambrogio. I think there is a window of opportunity also for Mr. Profumo, and then our Director General will tell you the rest of the story. Thank you very much.
Yes. No, I will certainly not speak in Italian, maybe in Latin, but I will switch to French and I will answer questions in English, French and German. Voilà, donc j'ai eu le plaisir et l'honneur en tant que membre d'un des États, en tant que représentant d'un des États membres qui a rejoint l'ESA en dernier, le Luxembourg. Nous avons rejoint l'ESA en 2005. Donc l'honneur d'avoir été choisi parmi nos collègues comme un des deux coprésidents, ce qui est d'ailleurs une nouveauté au sein de l'Union européenne, au sein de l'ESA, qu'on ait deux coprésidences. Je dois dire que c'était un plaisir de travailler ensemble avec Mauro Dell'Ambrogio. Le Luxembourg et la Suisse sont des pays qui ont beaucoup en commun, notamment cette multiculturalité et ce multilinguisme qui nous permet toujours de nous faire les interprètes, dans le double sens du terme, de nos collègues. Je ne m'étendrai pas longuement sur les résultats, je crois que le directeur général y reviendra. Je dois tout simplement dire qu'on était assez inquiets, Mauro Dell'Ambrogio et moi, avant de venir ici à Naples, parce que sur un arrière-front de crise économique, il s'agissait quand même d'engager les États membres sur des perspectives qui vont au-delà du demain, voire même du lendemain, mais où on doit développer des visions à plus long terme. Les grands sujets cruciaux sur lesquels on avait risqué de se diviser, les lanceurs, l'ISS, ont finalement trouvé des accords, tout comme d'autres projets. Je ne parlerai que d'un seul projet qui était à l'ordre du jour et qui était nouveau. C'était celui qu'on a mis dans une résolution des relations entre l'ESA et l'Union européenne. Il faut en effet savoir que beaucoup de données ont changé ces dernières années, depuis la dernière conférence ministérielle en 2008, et une de ces données, c'est la mise en vigueur, l'entrée en vigueur, le 1er janvier 2010, du traité de Lisbonne, qui, dans son article 189, donne des compétences à l'Union européenne. J'ai dit clairement des compétences, puisque l'espace reste avant tout une matière dévolue aux États membres. Donc l'intergouvernementalité, l'intergouvernementalisme qu'on connaît au sein de l'ESA, parce que nous sommes un organe, une institution intergouvernementale, reste quand même aussi la base des relations en Europe. Bien entendu, nous ne devons pas regarder cet article 189 du traité de Lisbonne comme un défi, si comme un défi, pas comme un danger, mais comme un défi et surtout comme une chance, puisque sur base de cet article, l'Union européenne, dans sa prochaine programmation financière, pourra développer beaucoup plus de fonds à investir dans l'espace. L'essentiel, c'est justement de savoir comment impliquer, comment engager ces deniers publics qui viennent du contribuable européen, comment les engager de la façon la plus efficace possible pour nos citoyens et pour nos contribuables. Il faut savoir que l'Union européenne a son passé, l'ESA a son passé. Je me souviens très bien du temps où le Luxembourg présidait l'Union européenne. Je présidais entre autres le Conseil des ministres de recherche en 2005 et j'ai présidé le deuxième Conseil espace de l'Union européenne à l'époque où on avait déjà adopté une résolution du Conseil des ministres de l'Union européenne pour dire quelles étaient surtout les missions à dévoluer à l'ESA et quelles étaient les missions à dévoluer l'Union européenne. Les discussions vont commencer très vite. Pourquoi ? Parce que la Commission européenne, sachant qu'on allait se réunir aujourd'hui, a issu une communication sur l'avenir de ses relations, communication qu'on discutera en tant que ministre de la Recherche en date du 11 décembre à Bruxelles. Nous avons donc adopté notre résolution qui donne des missions au directeur général, qui donne des missions à la coprésidence et notamment à celui de la coprésidence, et vous comprendrez maintenant comment cette coprésidence s'est constituée, à celui des deux coprésidents qui vient de l'Union européenne, dont l'État membre est un État, dont l'État d'origine est un fondateur de l'Union européenne, qui a présidé plusieurs présidences européennes. Et donc mon rôle sera surtout celui de rapprocher, surtout au niveau ministériel, les ministres qui sont membres de l'Union européenne et ceux qui sont membres de l'ESA. D'un autre côté, il ne faut jamais oublier qu'une des richesses de l'ESA, c'est justement d'avoir des membres qui ne sont pas membres de l'Union européenne, et d'où cette coprésidence avec un président qui vient de l'Union européenne et un président qui ne vient pas de l'Union européenne. Je crois que c'était une très riche idée qu'avait un certain nombre de nos collègues de nous demander de faire une coprésidence au lieu de candidater pour une présidence. Voilà donc pour mon introduction, et je suis absolument prêt à revenir sur toute question concernant les relations ESA-Union européenne, et je crois que c'est donc à Mauro de couvrir tout le reste.
Grazie François, mi esprimerò nella lingua nazionale svizzera che è anche la lingua del luogo qui e poi evidentemente posso rispondere alle domande in francese o in tedesco o in inglese come preferite. La Svizzera è membro fondatore dell'Agenzia Spaziale Europea ma non ha mai avuto finora la possibilità di rivestire la presidenza anche perché è una presidenza triennale quindi non cambia così spesso. È una novità anche questa della copresidenza. Ieri ci siamo impegnati al momento dell'elezione a far sì che la copresidenza non diventasse un fattore di complicazione, ma semmai un fattore per rafforzare la governance dell'agenzia, e credo che siamo riusciti a farlo in questi due intensi giorni di lavoro attraverso non solo la direzione dei lavori formali a questo tavolo, ma anche attraverso i numerosi negoziati dietro le quinte. È stato detto dal collega, il momento economico è difficile, il fatto che si sia riusciti comunque a trovare un consenso unanime tra tutti i Paesi membri per investimenti dell'ordine di 10 miliardi di euro. Il direttore generale potrà essere più preciso a questo titolo, credo che sia un segnale importante oggi in Europa. Va sottolineato che si tratta di investimenti che hanno un effetto immediato sulle attività scientifiche ed industriali in Europa. Il consenso non è stato facile, ci sono state e sussistono divergenze di interessi sia sui grandi programmi dell'Agenzia, da una parte i vettori, dall'altra la Stazione Spaziale Internazionale. Oltre al consenso su questi grandi progetti è stato possibile lanciarne di nuovi, ad esempio nel settore della meteorologia o delle telecomunicazioni. Quindi esprimo la grande soddisfazione della copresidenza per la riuscita di questa conferenza e ben volentieri cedo la parola al collega Profumo, che non solo è stato eccellente ospite e organizzatore della conferenza, ma che è anche il presidente uscente.
Grazie, grazie molto Mauro. Buon pomeriggio a tutti. Permettetemi innanzitutto di ringraziare il governo italiano che ci ha supportato nella gestione, nell'organizzazione di questo importante evento in una città come Napoli. E naturalmente tutte le autorità locali, la regione, il comune in particolare, che hanno consentito che in queste giornate intense di lavoro ci fosse anche una stretta relazione con la città e col territorio. E Da ultimo, solo nella mia lista, ma non certamente in termini di importanza, all'Agenzia Spaziale Italiana, che attraverso il suo presidente, l'ingegner Saggese e tutte le sue persone, ha consentito un'organizzazione di un evento complesso, a cui hanno partecipato 15 ministri, con un'organizzazione articolata di lavori giorno e notte. Quindi credo che veramente un sincero ringraziamento a tutte le persone che hanno partecipato. Io credo che da questi due giorni di lavoro siano emersi due elementi fondamentali. Uno è collegato al valore strategico dello spazio per l'Europa. E dico per l'Europa proprio perché i singoli paesi probabilmente da soli non hanno la possibilità di competere nella grande competizione internazionale, una competizione che è cambiata anche nei termini, è un mercato sempre più aperto, meno monopolistico e quindi le regole debbono essere cambiate e questo è certamente un elemento sul quale abbiamo profondamente riflettuto in questi giorni. E il risultato è un risultato estremamente positivo. Il ministro svizzero ha detto un investimento di 10 miliardi in un momento di difficoltà di tutti i nostri paesi, è certamente un elemento che potrà avere delle ricadute dirette e immediate in termini di sviluppi tecnologici, sviluppi scientifici e sviluppi industriali importanti per tutti i nostri paesi. Il secondo elemento è questa nuova relazione tra l'Unione Europea e l'Agenzia. Si è solo avviato questo processo, è un processo che avrà un passo fondamentale nel prossimo immediato, quindi l'11 di dicembre con il Consiglio della Competitività, ed è chiaro che si avvia un percorso interessante che parte proprio dal Trattato di Lisbona. Un'ultimissima considerazione relativa al nostro Paese. Il nostro Paese, con un investimento importante di oltre 650 milioni per i programmi opzionali e di 500 milioni per i programmi obbligatori, ha dimostrato la grandissima attenzione per lo spazio e ha anche giocato, credo, un ruolo abbastanza importante sui due grandi temi, che sono quello dei lanciatori, dove grazie all'attenzione di molti paesi il progetto Vega sta diventando un progetto per l'Europa, sempre più europeo, e dall'altra parte questa attività collegata alla stazione spaziale internazionale, che sarà almeno fino al 2020, dimostra anche come le grandi competenze che sono state sviluppate nel corso degli anni dalle nostre aziende in questo settore potranno avere una continuità. Grazie molto e buon lavoro a tutti.
Sì, grazie signori ministri. Do la parola al nostro direttore generale Jean-Jacques Dornat.
Thank you very much. So I shall speak in English because this is a price that I have to pay to have UK on board ISS. So I think that I have a commitment with the British minister that from now on I shall speak only in English. No, this is not true. This is just because my notes are in English and I have no more energy to translate them in French because it was an interesting 2 days and 2 nights. Okay, so I think that again, it was a very difficult council at ministerial level, but I was not expecting an easy one. But again, it's a successful council at ministerial level. It's a fact. Obviously, we have to digest the results because there was a lot of stress, a lot of discussions, night discussions. And I would like to thank the co-chairs who have made a great job, especially last night. But the previous chair, the previous night, so I must say that. So it was, yes, a lot of stress. But In spite of the stress, I have always felt that there was a willingness to succeed. So there was never a position from any minister saying we want a failure. I think that, and this is certainly the reason why at the end it's successful. So globally speaking, it was already said by the ministers. Okay. Globally speaking, we can say that this ministerial is worth 10 billions of euros. I can even give the exact figure, but okay, this is brand new. It's 10.119 million. I must say that this is in terms of money, depending on the economic conditions, but this is certainly in the standard of the last two councils at ministerial level, which were declared success. We can say a big success. And it's a big success in spite of the economic situation. And that is certainly, and I would like to start by that, it's certainly a recognition of the economic dimension of space activities. Space is not anymore expenses. Space is an investment, and it's an investment into economy. And I have said that in my introductory speech. This is not by chance that this is the Chancellor, George Osborne, who has announced himself that UK would increase its contribution to ESA by 25%, and 25%, it's not bad. And this is the Minister of Finance announcing that. It's not very usual that the Minister of Finance celebrate additional investments. And that, it's a clear demonstration for me, and this is true from all member states of ESA. I think that they all recognize, in spite, and even those who were in even more difficult economic situation, they are all recognizing that investing in space, it's investing into the economy, and that is certainly, for me, the basic reason for the success. And this is the reason why I have put my proposal to the ministers under the general heading of competitiveness and growth, and I think that it was well understood. So to have competitiveness and growth, as I have told to the minister when I have presented my proposal, there is four pillars to support competitiveness and growth. Number one is investments. Let's start by the investments. Number two, it's innovation to go into the future. Number three, it's leverage. How can we make leverage of these investments to make them even more important? Number four, the efficiency. So in terms of investments, as I said, it's the subscription, including the level of resource, obviously, but the global subscription of the member states is around 10 billion of euro, which is pretty well balanced between the three strategic objectives of the investments, which were, I recall, pushing knowledge. Supporting the competitiveness of European industry, and number three, the services. So this is the three strategic objectives under which I have organized the proposal. And if I look at the distribution of these 10 billion, it's around 4.2 for pushing knowledge, 3.7 to support the competitiveness of European industry, and 2.2 in terms of services, enabling services, because obviously we are not delivering services, but we are making the development able to deliver services. So in terms of knowledge, this is basically the science and the mandatory part of the science, the level of resource. So the member states, after some interesting discussion, they have accepted to put on top of their, let's say, the 18 member states coming from the past, if I may say that, they have accepted to have the contribution of the new member states, Romania and Poland. Yes, I should have started that Poland became the 20th member state on Monday at 11:21. So this is the phone call that I have received from the Foreign Affairs Ministry of France, where the ratification of Poland had to be delivered. So the 18 member states of the past have accepted to put the contribution of Poland and Romania on top of their contribution, but they have asked me to have a flat cash budget, so we have 5 years of a flat cash budget. Obviously, I was proposing more, but okay, this is what I have got, and we shall manage with that. So that this is for the science, the mandatory part of the science. We had also the fourth slice of the Earth Observation Envelope Program, and part of the knowledge, because now it's the utilization of ISS. We have ISS exploitation, which has been decided, and part of the ISS exploitation program. Now we shall start to work on the service module of the MPCV, and that this is certainly good news, because this is an agreement that we have with NASA to, as you know, to pay our share of common operation cost to the space station in delivering hardware to the crew transportation that NASA is developing. And the first flight is to go to the moon. So we can say that we shall be part of the first flight of the MPCV by delivering the service module. So that it's for knowledge. Competitiveness, it's, I shall start by telecommunications. Telecommunications is a very important program for the competitiveness of European industry. As you know, telecom program is made only in public-private partnership. This is not an ESA program, this is the ESA part of public-private partnership, and the telecommunication program has been subscribed, let's say, more or less at the level of what it was in 2008. Part of the competitiveness is also the launch services, and as the ministers were saying, it was one of the most interesting part of the discussion during the 2 days and two nights. The ministers, they have agreed, so they have supported the funding of the exploitation of Ariane and Vega, and they have decided to continue the development of Ariane 5 ME while trying to adapt the Ariane 5 ME in order to develop the commonalities with the second decision that they have taken, which is to start the detailed definition of Ariane 6 with an invitation to the Director General to provide by 2014 the industrial commitments in terms of development and the production cost of Ariane 6. So, and also the start of the program of Vega evolution and consolidation. So you see that this is a well-balanced decision taken by the member states, made of support to exploitation of existing launch vehicle, new development concerning the competitiveness of Ariane with the perspective of Ariane 5 ME adapted and Ariane 6, and the evolution of Vega. And the third part of the competitiveness is the technology program, and I can say that the GSTP, which is the technology program of ESA, is in a significant increase, so demonstrating that the member states, they wish to invest in new technologies to develop the competitiveness of their industry. The third strategic objective is services, and with that, the member states have decided to contribute to the new generation of meteorology in polar orbit, METOP second generation. As you know, this is a program which is made in agreement with our partner, our usual partner, EUMETSAT. And by the way, I would like to mention that 1 hour ago, I have signed the agreement with EUMETSAT on METEOSAT third generation, which has been decided in 2008, so it was a way to demonstrate to the ministers that we are working between two councils at ministerial level, in case they don't know. So we have signed the agreement with EUMETSAT on the Meteosat third generation, and they have decided to make their contribution to the development of METOP second generation. So that is certainly very good news for ESA, but also for EUMETSAT. They have also decided to continue and even increase the funding to the preparation of the next generation of Galileo. We are already preparing the next generation of Galileo. As you know, this program is a bridging program to the Horizon 2020, because the assumption is that the Commission will fund the preparation and the development of the next generation of Galileo under their funding. But the member states, they have strongly supported the interim program that we were proposing. We shall also start the GMES space component number 3, which is made of Sentinel-5. And Sentinel-5 will fly on board. This is an instrument which will fly on board METOP second generation. And also JSON-CS, which is a continuation of the altimetry. They have financed, for some of them, only the phase one, because they are waiting for the funding of the GMES by the European Union. But some others have already contributed to the phase two, so meaning that some member states, they have already anticipated that GMES will be funded from the EU budget, and we shall see that tomorrow. Last but not least, the increase of funding for the integrated application program, meaning that the integrated application program is now something which is well established in the ESA system, and I am certainly glad of that, because this is a promotion of services based on a combination of data from space but also from ground. So that was for the investments. As I said, not bad in these times. Speaking of innovation, we have a lot of new products to prepare and to develop. I have already mentioned the adapted Ariane 5ME and Ariane 6. This is clearly now we are entering into a new phase of Ariane, I have to prepare the decisions in 2014, but clearly these decisions will be based on as many commonalities as possible that we can organize between Ariane 5ME and Ariane 6. The second product, innovative product, is certainly the service module of MPCV. This is the first time that ESA is contributing to a crew transport vehicle, and certainly also the first time that there is a cooperation between ESA and NASA on a crew transportation vehicle. This is, for me, certainly a breakthrough. In terms of telecommunications, we shall develop two new platforms with NEOSAT on one side and Electra on the other side, which is the electric propulsion based on the small GEO platform. METOP second generation is also a brand new technology for this new generation of meteorology in polar orbit, and EGEPT is also a new type of technology. So just to say that, as I said in my speech, 2020 in ESA is now, 2020 is not tomorrow, it's now at ESA. I have already mentioned the fact that another breakthrough and certainly innovation is to have UK on board ISS, and that it's I think that it's an historical event. When I arrived at ESA, UK was on Columbus because of the Polar Platform. They have quitted that soon after. Okay, they are on board the space station. Not bad. The third pillar of the economy is certainly leverage. I shall go quick on that. The leverage is the fact that almost all these programs are done in partnership, and especially the science and exploration programs, they are almost all made in international cooperation. And I am glad to report that it was the day before the Council at ministerial level, the agreement with Roscosmos on ExoMars has been agreed by the Council. So let's say on the ESA side, I can say that this agreement is in force. We have, as I said already, a lot of partnership in terms of telecommunications, which certainly increase the leverage of the investments made by the Member States in telecommunication. And for the services, EUMETSAT, the European Commission, they are our partners, and they are making the investments also of Member States much bigger than they are only through ESA. I shall finish by efficiency. First of all, the efficiency of ESA. I have promised and I am committed to the Member States to further increase the efficiency of ESA. As I have said, there are limits to the reduction of internal cost of ESA, because ESA is not an administration. ESA is a lot of expertise which are contributing to the success of the ESA mission. So obviously, I don't want to go below the limit which would start to be to the detriment of our expertise. But okay, I have a commitment to increase the efficiency of ESA. The second part of the efficiency of the of what we are doing is the relationship with industry. We have in Resolution 1 a full chapter dedicated to the relationship between ESA and industry, which certainly will improve the efficiency of what we are doing with industry. And I shall obviously end my report by saying that yes, the resolution number 4, which is a draft political declaration, which speaks of evolution of ESA, and especially the relationship between ESA and EU, has been adopted by all ministers. They are all insisted on the fact that the process on the ESA side should be closely coordinated with the process on the EU side, because there is a communication which has been recently issued on the relationship between EU and ESA on the EU side. And since, as I have said many times, we have 18 common member states, 18 common ministers, I am confident that because 18 common member states is 90% of the ESA member states and 2/3 of the EU member states, meaning that it's a significant majority, and I am convinced that the ministers will ensure the coordination. But even more than that, all the EU member states which were present have supported this resolution. So this is a resolution of the ESA member states, but for the first time there is an article in this resolution saying that the EU member states, not yet member of ESA, present at the meeting, but also in writing, because two of them for different reasons could not be present in Naples, they are also supporting this resolution. Not bad, not bad. So this is a resolution of not only the ministers of ESA, but supported by the EU member states. And I must say, this resolution number 4 was such a consensus that it was the easiest part, because it has been adopted yesterday. This was the only decision taken yesterday, just to demonstrate that it was the easiest part of ESA, which is good news. That the member states, they are taking care of the evolution of ESA. So this is my report. I think that this good success gives us the right to continue, but also the duty to continue to be successful. And this is why ESA is good. It's because ESA is successful. I would like to thank all delegations because this is their success, it's not mine. Thanks the ministers who have chaired the council, and it's always good to have ministers next to me. And I would like to thank also my colleagues of ESA, just to say that when I am speaking, I have 2,000 persons behind me because they are all part of the work which has been done. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of them, because I know that preparing a council at ministerial level within the ESA executive is not easy, because this is in addition to continuing to make the best satellite and the best launchers of the world. So not easy to take on board 9 months of additional work to prepare a council at ministerial level. So a big thank to my colleagues. So thank you very much. This is the report that I wanted to make.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Director General. Now the floor is to you. I would like to point out that we have 3 working languages, English, French, and Italian. And I invite you to raise your hand so that I can identify you, and then I give the floor to you, and you switch on the mic, and then you switch it off. Introduce yourself first and state your affiliation. Thank you very much.
Peter Desalding, Space News. For the Director General, a general question. Where's the Director General? Oh, he's there. Sorry. Hi. Could we get copies of as much documentation showing numbers as you can legally and humanly give us before nightfall?
I am surprised that you have not yet the documents, but okay. That I shall turn to my colleagues. You will get what you can get. I must say that we are still working. I can tell you that, and this is not, this is all in handwriting, because we have to look, there were more than 30 programs, different programs being subscribed, and we have not yet the papers. You can get the resolution, that this is for sure, and in the resolution, at least for the level of resource and for the funding of the Centre Spatial Guyanais, I think that the resolutions include the figures. For the figures of the optional programs, we need some time to consolidate that. I assume that you will get that. Anyway, there is no secret, so you will get that.
Okay, and this would include Resolution 4 today, which, as you said, was short and easy?
Oh, Resolution 4, yes, you can have the copy today. Because that one, I must say, has been... There was a small change compared to the version which came on the table of the... of the ministers, so that one, okay, I don't know where it is, because I am sorry, but you will get that as soon. Of 1,250 millions, and this was more or less 1 billion for everything except the barter element, because the commitment that we are asking for the barter element was a part of the 450. This is the commitment that we need to work with, but there will be the complementary subscription in 2014. The 1 billion part outside the barter element is basically the launch of ATV-4 and ATV-5 together with their operations and the Columbus operations until the end of 2014. So this is what has been covered. We have not got the 1,250 We have not got the 1,250 millions. We have got a little bit less, but we shall make some savings to compensate the deficit. But we can work, and we shall start the MPCV service module from tomorrow on.
Sorry, is ESA capable of telling NASA today that ESA is in the station to 2020, or not quite yet?
As well as NASA is saying that they are until 2020, I must say that NASA has a yearly budget, and I am much more lucky than they are. So I am more solid than NASA.
Okay.
Today we are starting the development of an MPCV SM, and as you know, it's to cover our obligations from 2018 to 2020. So, frankly speaking, I feel much more solid than NASA. I have not a yearly budget myself. I have a multi-year commitment.
Okay, and last question for me on Ariane 5 ME and 6. That too, I think the council agreed to actually go through to a flight of Ariane 5 ME in 2017. Could you give us an idea of the numbers for the Ariane 6 preparatory studies and the budget for Ariane 5 ME?
That I have to look at the figures, but what I can tell you is that we have got the commitment to continue Ariane 5 ME until 2014, so for a launch date of 2017 or 2018, and we have got the funding for making all detailed definition activities on Ariane 6 in order to get in 2014 an industrial commitment for the development and the production of Ariane 6. So this is what we have got, that it's very clear. And during these 2 years, I have to work on developing as many commonalities as possible between the two launchers, it being understood that there is already a significant common part, which is the engine. The engine and the propulsion system will be the same. So that is done. But I have now to work to see if and how I can develop more commonalities between the two launchers.
Other questions? Yes, please introduce yourself.
To say, and this is the reason why it is called adapted Ariane 5 ME, because developing more commonalities may come to some adaptation. But it's clear that the launch of this Ariane 5 ME adapted is for 2017-2018.
Thank you. Richard Ingham from Agence France-Presse. Monsieur Dornin, when one looks at this, the very wide panoply of activities in which ESA is involved. Here we're talking about human flight in space, we're talking about the science missions, we're talking about Earth observation. All of this very broad panorama of activities in which ESA has to commit its spending. And when you look at two things, first of all, the emergence of rivals, especially commercial rivals, in part of these activities, and also the growing constraints on budgets, is it not compelling to come to a conclusion that ESA cannot do all things, that it must narrow down and perhaps focus on one or two or three things in which it really is a world leader?
We are already world leader in several niches. I must say that we are not looking for becoming world leader. We are world leader. We are world leader in meteorology services. No one is equal to our meteorology services. We are leader in some scientific missions. Who has made Herschel and Planck in the world? So who has developed as many Earth Explorer satellites as we have developed in the last years? So we are a small agency. I would like to have the budget of NASA and even to have the budget of the DOD, but I have not. But frankly speaking, with the budget that we have, I don't feel that we are not world leader. But clearly, the member states, because this is not my priority, the member states, they are putting their priority, as I said, in knowledge, competitiveness, and services. Yes, we are engaged in human space flights, for example, but this is certainly not. Human space flights are important for ESA, but they are not taking 50% of our budget as it could take in other space agencies. So there is clearly priorities on knowledge, competitiveness, and services. You said it's a wide range, but they are all linked. They are all linked. If we can make the best operational services of the world in meteorology and certainly on GMES, it's because we have also a science program in Earth observation. Because all the progress that we are making in science are directly translated into services. And if we are able to make science, it's because we have good technology. So there is a link between knowledge, competitiveness, and services. This is not activities which are totally separated. There is no walls. And this is of interest to have all these activities in ESA. It's because there is a lot of synergy between knowledge, competitiveness, and services. And this is the reason why we are not bad, in spite of our low budget. Because, yes, if I compare ESA to other space agencies, the only dream that I can have if I look at other space agencies is their budget, but maybe not their results.
Thank you. We have to, I have to apologize. Minister Bilkin has to catch a plane. If there is someone wanting to ask a question to Mr. Bilkin, raise your hand now. Otherwise, we thank him very much and he can be freed. Question? Okay.
Sorry, Minister Bilkin. Reference was made to the EC communication of November 14. I presume you've read it, and I read it. Do you like it? You spend a lot of time talking about Norway and Switzerland and the incompatibility at ESA of having those members and working on defense and security with the EU. So my question is, do you like the general tenor of this document?
I'm happy that there is a communication. I will, on December 11, make some reservations to some of the elements of these communications. Just remember, this is a communication of the Commission. It has to be discussed and it has to be to be transformed in conclusions by the Council of Ministers of Research. And we will do that probably on December 11th. It's of course that you will probably hear me in Brussels making some restraints because if it's true that there are differences between European Union and ESA, I know both very well, these differences are not so big that we cannot, for instance, try to find common functioning. I'll give you one example. Of course, ESA is intergovernmental, but Article 189 is also largely based on intergovernmental. Of course, if we are talking about budget of EU, we are in co-decision. But on other issues, it's the Council of Ministers who will be the main decision institution in the EU. So therefore, it's important that we have a lot of ministers here and the same ministers in the Council of Ministers. And I do really not see that the fact that some countries are not, some member states of the ESA are not members of the EU, that will not allow us to do a good collaboration. I see. I'm very confident there, and I will make my statements on the 11th of December.
Okay, if you can switch off.
So with this, we excuse two ministers. Thank you very much, Mr. Bilkin, and thank you very much, Minister Profumo, who's called to a meeting at the Senate, and we continue with Mr. Dordain and Mr. Dell'Ambrogio, and I take other questions in a second. So, and as time is running, I can take maximum of two, three more questions because we are supposed to end in 2 minutes from now. Raise your hand, please. Next in line for questions, starting with this lady here. Sorry, introduce yourself and excuse me. Yes, okay, I'll give you the floor.
Yeah, Dan Thisdell from Flight Global. You may be aware that Elon Musk spoke in London on Friday, and he was quite firm in his conviction that no variant of Ariane 5 could be competitive with Falcon 9 or Falcon 9 Heavy. Therefore, you know, we need an Ariane 6 if it's going to be a worthwhile exercise. Now, we're going in that direction. I know you've got a couple of years to outline the parameters here, but at this point, is it possible to give us a rough guide of the sort of performance or cost improvements that you would be expecting from that program?
Okay, I have not read that because I have no time to read anything, but does it mean that Monsieur Elon Musk wants to contribute to Ariane 6, or I don't know. Okay, so no, because if I have another contributor, I must say that we are more than ready to get additional contributors. I must say that clearly the requirements for Ariane 6 have been defined by the customers. I have worked during 18 months with the European customers of Ariane, and among them the government, obviously, which are using Ariane, but also the European operators. So it was SES, Inmarsat, Eutelsat, Hispasat, Avanti, okay, you can have the list. And I have worked with them during 18 months and asked them what is the launcher that you would dream of. And they have answered. They have given me their dreams. And now what I wish to do is to tell the launcher industry in Europe, okay, how can you fulfill the dreams of the customers? This is the exercise that we have done. So what I can tell you is that in broad terms, the customers, they want the most reliable vehicle of the world. And at least on that, Ariane 5 is certainly much more reliable than a lot of other vehicles. And I hope that Falcon 9 will be as reliable as that, but at least we can say that we are reliable. So they want a launcher which is reliable, which is available, which launch between 3 to 3.5 tons to 6.5 tons, and very easy to know why. It's because 6 to 6.5 is Proton and 3 to 3.5 is Falcon 9, so at least we know which are the competitors. And number 4, it's that they are cheaper than Proton and Falcon 9, so okay, this is the cahier des charges. Now we have to work. And this is what I have to do in the next 18 months, and we shall see. I cannot tell you today, before industry has worked, what will be the development cost and the recurring cost, but this is what the invitation that I have got from member states to provide by 2014, and work will start tomorrow. But the requirements are very clear, and by the way, I think that, and we shall make some publicity of that, we have developed what we call a declaration of intent between the Director General of ESA and these European customers to continue the dialogue between them and ourselves to see how we can involve the customers, not in terms of money, but in terms of requirements, in terms of what they are looking for, because what we would like is to make again the launcher that the customers are dreaming, and okay, we should try. But obviously Ariane 6, as I said many times, will not be available before 2021, meaning that since Ariane 5 is very reliable, obviously, and this is also a demand from the customers, is to organize a transition between a very reliable vehicle like Ariane 5 and a new vehicle, Ariane 6. So Ariane 5 is still there for 12 years. And this is the reason why it's worthwhile also to improve Ariane 5. And if we could organize commonalities between the improvement of Ariane 5 and Ariane 6, much better, especially for the budgets of the member states. Okay, so this is the strategy.
Thank you. I take the last question, Giovanni Caprara.
Giovanni Caprara, Corriere della Sera. Due domande. La prima è se in questo sforzo di sviluppo dell'Ariane 5 ME è previsto anche un abbassamento dei suoi costi di esercizio per renderlo più competitivo, visto che deve durare ancora molto lungo nel mercato. E la seconda è quali sono i paesi che condividono la partecipazione al programma MPCV assieme alla NASA?
Okay, it's clear that if we If the member states are financing the adapted Ariane 5 ME, it's to improve the competitiveness of Ariane 5, because if not, I think that they would miss the objective. So clearly, the development of the adapted Ariane 5 ME is to improve the competitiveness. By the way, one of the problems that we have today with Ariane ECA is that the upper stage is not restartable, and that is certainly a limitation vis-à-vis the market. And and this is the reason why developing an upper stage for Ariane 5, and especially a restartable upper stage, will certainly improve its competitiveness. Now, today, I am not able to tell you how much this will reduce the exploitation cost. We have still to work on that. But the target is clearly to reduce the exploitation cost of Ariane 5. And to further reduce them with Ariane 6. So it's this is the goal, that this is very clear. This is the only way to be competitive. For what concerns the members, the member states which will be which will contribute to MPCV ESM, this is the contributor to the ISS program. MPCV ESM development is part of the ISS exploitation program. So all participating states to ISS exploitation program will have access to the development of MPCVSM. Now we have to work on the industrial capacity which will be involved there. As you know, MPCVSM is also there not only to pay our share of common operation cost, not only to cooperate with NASA, but also to build the future on the capacity, industrial capacity that we have developed for ITV. So there is a relationship between the industrial capacity developed for ITV and the MPCVSM. But it's open to all participating states to ISS, including UK now.
So, okay, thank you very much for participating to this press conference, for your interest. Thank you, our Director General Jean-Jacques Dordain, Minister Dell'Ambrogio, and see you in a while, either in Switzerland or in Luxembourg, TBC. Thank you very much.
I am sure that I should see them before.